and creating this incredible space. It's been so wonderful to hear each and every one of these speakers. I'm so honored to be sharing this platform with you. I'm so excited to be playing Massey Hall. I mean, I know that this, you know, this has all kinds of historical resonances for people, but for me, it's just the place where I've seen all my favorite bands. So I'm a little, this is, as far as I'm concerned, the only good thing that has come out of the security crackdown in Toronto is that we got upgraded to Massey Hall. Were on the streets trying to get to the OCAP demonstration, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. But we weren't able to get there because the cops had blocked it off and sealed it in. And there was a line of riot police that marched right in front of us, and they were banging their shields with their batons. I hate that noise more than anything in the world. It chills me. And it was so wonderful to be able to come into this hall and listen to the women of Raw banging their mallets. Wow. That's scary. And remember that that is a whole other kind of power and transformation. And thank you for that. Now, I don't know why, but I find myself thinking about the garbage strike. Do you remember the garbage strike?
Yeah.
Now, I know there's some people here from out of town. What I'm referring to is the fact that at this time last year, our municipal garbage collectors went on strike against an attempt to roll back benefits and freeze their wages. That's true, but for this story, we're going to stick with the garbage workers, because for weeks, there was a foul, foul odor down by the water as bags of rotting detritus festered and rats multiplied. And I just kept wondering, what is it about Toronto's waterfront in the summer? It always seems to be something. But I have to say, after walking the cop gauntlet to get here tonight, I'd take the garbage over the G20 any day of the week. There's not much scarier in the world than having to watch Stephen Harper lecture the governments of the world about how they should be running their countries, because I don't really fully understand why Stephen Harper has the right to run this country. Now, I want to talk about the G20. I want to talk about the G20 genesis. Because it's pretty mysterious, you know, it sort of seemed to come out of nowhere. What is this body that has descended on our city? And I think a lot of Canadians are frankly ambivalent about it, because it sounds internationalist and multilateral, and we like that. You know, we consider ourselves multilateralists, and we're proud of our tradition supporting the United Nations, helping to draft the UN Declaration on Human Rights, and Pearson's championing of the 0.7 target for foreign aid, which we have systematically refused to meet every year since. So, given that there is this confusion, I think it's really important that we get one thing straight, which is that the G20 has absolutely nothing to do with multilateralism. More than that, it is a war being waged on real multilateralism, because it is a clear attempt to sideline and marginalize the already weak United Nations. Now, this government of ours doesn't like forums where it can be outvoted by poor countries. That's why they're constantly walking out of forums, the General Assembly, and boycotting the UN Conference on Racism, because they don't like real democracy. The idea of the G20 was to include a few developing countries into the club, but not so many that Western states would actually get outvoted, as they so frequently do at the UN, and only invite the friendly ones. Now, earlier this week, the Globe and Mail had a fascinating story about the origins of the G20. I don't know if many of you read it. But it was really revealing. It was like this insider history how it all came to be. And it turns out it all came out of a meeting in 1999 between Paul Martin, then Canada's finance minister, and Larry Summers, then Bill Clinton's nominee for Treasury Secretary. So right off the top, that's interesting, because 1999 was the year that Larry Summers pushed through a piece of legislation that killed a law called Glass-Steagall. And that law was what prevented investment banks from merging with commercial banks. And that law was what prevented the kind of intermingling that created exactly the situation of these intermerged and intermingled financial institutions that were called too big to fail. He also is the guy, as Treasury Secretary, who fought tooth and nail against regulating derivatives in the 90s. So in other words, the G20, ostensibly born to prevent economic crisis, as we've been told, was actually created by the individual who arguably is most responsible for creating the conditions of the current global economic crisis.